As a psychologist, I'd like to ask you if you could possibly help me understand the one issue a little bit better. I know that a lot of transgender people, the term that used to be applied to them was gender dysphoria. This person has gender dysphoria. Is that still a current term?
It is. And in fact, just up until 2013, the term was gender identity disorder, right? Now it's gender dysphoria. It's in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the fifth edition. The gender identity disorder was in the DSM-IV and before that. So it's a mental health condition. It's there. It's in the book. No, but look, many people suffer from depression, anxiety, and so on. These are in the book as well. So just because someone has a condition, by saying they have a condition, it's not that we're saying that they're not human. It's not right. That we're trying to denigrate them in any way.
It's not a moral judgment.
It's not a moral judgment at all. It's just a factual statement that, now, some people can just say, well, who's to say that, that's the right label to give? Well, these are people themselves who have said, I have a great discomfort being in this physical body. You know, that's what the dysphoria is. It's a significantly distressing experience of saying, like, I just am not comfortable in this body. You know, it caused me this distress, concern, etc., and other negative feelings. Okay, that's what dysphoria is. And many people who have this condition will admit to these feelings. So there's nothing wrong with saying that. So that's gender dysphoria.
Okay.
But it's like saying, for example, that somebody who has schizophrenia, or this is closer to home, bipolar disorder. My father has bipolar disorder, okay? Undiagnosed for many years. He's an artist. No one knew he had what used to be called manic depression. Nobody knew that because he's an artist. Right. He's a crazy, literally crazy artist. He's expected to do the crazy things that he would do. No one knew that. Oh, it was a mental health condition going on, okay? So the reason I bring this up is far too many people say, oh, I love having bipolar disorder, okay, or schizophrenia, or some, Asperger's, because they try to rationalize it and say it's a blessing. Well, most people who have these conditions don't say it's a blessing. They say it's a curse or something along those lines, but I need to learn to adapt it, learn to work around, with this issue, okay? So again, talking about someone's gender dysphoria, all we're saying is this is a situation that they find themselves in. It's a condition they have. Let's find the best way to help them, okay? And that's it. But unfortunately, ideologies have taken over. So here's the thing. So if a child at 3 years old, and this is not me making this up here. I'm on a forum with a lot of people who are doing research and who work with, trans people. I have several patients who are, who are trans. They have gender dysphoria. And so, but my numbers are small. So these people who have much larger numbers, okay? So here's what happens. A child is 3 years old. Let's say it's a boy, a physical boy. Suddenly says, I'm a girl today. Normally you say, okay, you don't want, the terrible parents would make the child feel terrible, saying that. They would disown him. They would, say, you're not going to play with dolls or anything. That's the bad parenting.
Right.
Right? The proper parents would say, okay, I accept you for who you are. Let's see how this goes. Okay? Don't interfere. Don't push him in one direction or another. Let's see how it plays itself out. Because we know that 80% of children who say these things, if you don't do anything, later on they'll revert back to their physical body. Like they'll say, no, I'm a boy. Okay,
right.
But these ideologues, they say, no, bring him into this clinic, we'll diagnose him right away and say, yep, and let's start him on the path toward becoming a girl. Let's help him transition.
Right, they push that on them very young, right?
Very young, before they know, before the child knows what's going on. This is ridiculous, well, and it's unhealthy.
Is there any research or data to show if the childhood condition of the dysphoria, is there a biological trigger for that dysphoria, or is it some sort of psychological development issue?
Yeah, that's a really tricky
one. Is that an unknown area?
The answer is we don't know.
Right. Okay.
People make claims, and they talk about the brains of, people with gender dysphoria being more like a man, so if you're a man with gender dysphoria, or if you're transgender, gender dysphoria, if you're a male who's transgender believing that you're a woman, they say their brain is more like a woman's brain than a man's brain, so it proves it's neurological. And,
right, I've heard that.
Right. But again, this is preliminary research, small sample sizes usually, and again, the answer is we really don't know. We're trying to know more, okay? And ideologues on either side or any side of this issue are just, coming running in and trying to ram their their agendas and ideology down everyone's throats, and it's not healthy. We need to step back and find out what is the best thing to do for any given individual. That's the approach.
Agreed. Let me play devil's advocate for a minute, though. I recently saw an interview on Joe Rogan's podcast, and I can't remember the academic that he was interviewing, but it was a left-wing academic from the States. And they got in a very heated argument about the concept of being crazy or having a mental disorder. And the the academic that he was talking to was saying his view was that there's really no such thing as crazy, that that's sort of a cultural construct. And a lot of people that have a like gender dysphoria or a condition might take offense because, let's say I was sitting here and I had gender dysphoria, you telling me that I'm crazy or that I have a disorder, I might take offense to that and say, well, like you're really imposing your sort of cultural, structural thing onto me. And like it, so do you, how would we get to the bottom of, like, is gender an actual, is it a spectrum here, or is this some sort of, are we in a postmodern world where we can just do away with this sort of thinking, or what? It's very confusing.
It's extremely confusing, and I get worried when anyone says, this is how it is. And unfortunately, many of my colleagues say, this is how it is, all right? Mm-hmm. They conflate their personal beliefs with fact. And I'm very clear in my classes. I say, here's what this research says, here's what my clinical experience says, here's what other, you know, clinicians have found. And here's my belief. I'm always differentiating them, okay? So if you came to me and said, you know, let's say if you came to me saying that you're depressed, you have gender dysphoria, or you transgender, let's say, okay? Let's say transgender, or, you know, bipolar disorder, anything. You know what? I'm not going to label you. I'm not going to say you have a disorder. I'm going to say, tell me about your experience. If it's disrupting your functioning in some way. See, these are the criteria that I use, okay? And we're supposed to use these basically. If whatever situation you're dealing with either causes you significant distress or it significantly impairs your functioning, then you have an issue, okay? So if you came to me and said, I believe I'm a woman, all right, I wouldn't say, oh, you have a mental health issue. I'd say, okay, tell me more about that. Why do you believe this? What can we do to help you, you know, kind of come to terms with whatever's going on, okay? Maybe if you tell me, I feel like I'm a woman and I don't want to feel that way, I would say, okay, well, let's look at, you know, what you can do about that. Okay, I would never impose on you any path. Okay, and the same with depression. If you say you're depressed, okay, I'm going to say, well, tell me about it, and let's find out what's the best for you. That's pretty much how I approach these things, and you know, especially when it comes to gender issues, because again, I can't stress this enough. We don't know enough. Is it a spectrum? I don't believe so. I believe that, you know, and we've been talking about this, and Jordan Peterson says this a lot, there's a huge correlation between one's physical body, their sense of, you know, maleness or femaleness, and, you know, their sexual orientation. These are very strongly correlated. The vast majority of people have, you know, they're kind of locked in sync.
Right.
But there are some, you know, anomalies, so to speak, statistically speaking, where, you know, again, I do believe that there are people who truly believe that they're born in the wrong body. I'm not going to call it a disorder. I'm just going to say it's a condition they have, okay? We definitely know that there are people who are attracted to not the opposite sex, but the same sex, right? Or both, or other things. There's, you know, that's a spectrum in the sense that we have all these different, you know, interests and beliefs and so on. But when it comes to biology, I believe there are males, there are females physically, right? And as far as this construct of gender, I mean, that is a construct, okay? What does it mean to be a man? What does it mean to be a woman? Okay. Yeah, that is because every culture has a different variation on what these things are. Okay. But the fact is, you know, every culture.
When you say there's cultures have variation on that, but right. Is there a baseline universal? I would argue that there would be universal traits of masculinity that are cross-cultural, right?
Exactly. So, that's what I was going to say. So we have different shades, but the fact is the colors are, you know, there's colors with spectrums within them. Okay. Right. So yes. There is something to be masculine, or, and you know, what does it mean to be feminine? Yes, and a lot of people don't fit neatly into that. And in the old days, someone just said, I just don't fit into that, you know, or I might be more feminine, okay, or I'm more in touch with my masculine side, or metrosexual, or whatever. But now it's all lumped under this umbrella term transgender, you know. And there was an article written earlier this year by a woman who said, my daughter is not transgender, she's just a tomboy.
Right.
And she got so much flack for that. Oh, are you trans? So, no, it's like, dude. It was simple. The girl knows who she is. She knows she's a girl, but she doesn't have all the, you know, girl interests.
That's a very interesting topic as well, because a lot of the people will try to frame these topics around hate and things like that. But as a psychologist, do you have an opinion on, I'm wondering what the real the motives of the parents are who force this on their kids when they're younger, because they'll say it's about compassion and virtue, but I'm not convinced of that, because it's, you know, it's not really responsible to be forcing that on a kid, right? So what's going on with the parents?
Well, you got it half right. It's virtue signaling. Okay. You know, and as I always say, it's not being able to differentiate between righteousness and self-righteousness.
I see.
Okay? Right. So yeah, so what these parents are doing is, for whatever reason, I'm not going to say what their motives are, okay, but it looks like they are trying to gain brownie points. They're trying to show the world how progressive they are, okay? Or, and this is something I've seen with a lot of people, and this is not to denigrate anybody's experience. Look, I work with so many people, and trauma is such a common, you know, unfortunately, historical experience for not just people I work with, but everybody. Statistically speaking, we know a lot of people suffer some form of abuse or trauma, okay? So what I'm seeing is a lot of people are using these arguments, all right, as kind of a way for them to try to kind of heal from, okay, or get revenge, you know, heal from some kind of abuse, get revenge on some, right. You know, is this construct of, you know, this person who abused them. So for these parents, okay, maybe they feel disempowered in their lives. Maybe they felt that their parents didn't give them the recognition or whatever it happens to be, right? So now is their opportunity to step up and say, no, I'm going to, you know, they're doing it with their child. Okay. It's like the hockey parent who, you know, makes their kids skate on the ice for 20 hours because they were the failed hockey player themselves. And I'm not going to say this with every parent, right. But I've seen that with so many people that it just seems to be that there's something else going on here that goes beyond the ostensible, you know, cause that's being fought.
Of course. As a parent, my logical concern for my child would be their health and safety and physically and mentally, right? So I would definitely be hesitant to force any kind of thing on them when it's a confusing subject. Right?
Exactly. And it's something we don't know. Again, well, what we do know is this. We know this. If you force hormones onto a young child, okay, so if it's a girl and you put hormone blockers, okay, so, you know, we know it's going to affect their reproductive systems, right? That we do know. So why would you condemn a child who might somewhere down the line say, whoa, I don't know what I was thinking. I was wrong or whatever. Eliminated choice.
As you said, statistically, the majority of kids with the symptoms of gender dysphoria younger grow out of it at puberty, right?
And again, I'm just, because we're saying gender dysphoria, but you have to meet certain criteria. Let's just say they feel transgender, okay? Because they may not actually feel dysphoric about it. They might feel fine about it, right? Yes. So yes, they will grow out of it. They will feel that their natal sex, their physical body, is who they are, okay? That they are the boy.
As a psychologist, I'd like to ask you if you could possibly help me understand the one issue a little bit better. I know that a lot of transgender people, the term that used to be applied to them was gender dysphoria. This person has gender dysphoria. Is that still a current term?
It is. And in fact, just up until 2013, the term was gender identity disorder, right? Now it's a body. You know, that's what the dysphoria is. It's a significantly distressing experience of saying, like, I'm not comfortable in this body. You know, it causes me this distress, concern, etc., and other negative feelings. Okay, that's what dysphoria is. And many people who have this condition will admit to these feelings. So there's nothing wrong with saying that. So that's gender dysphoria. It's in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the 5th edition. The gender identity disorder was in the DSM-4 and before that. So it's a mental health condition. It's there. It's in the book. No, but look, many people suffer from depression, anxiety, and so on. These are in the book as well. So just because someone has a condition, by saying they have a condition, it's not that we're saying that they're not human. It's not that we're trying to denigrate them in any way.
It's not a moral judgment.
It's not a moral judgment at all. It's just a factual statement that, now, some people can just say, well, who's to say that, you know, that's the right label to give? Well, these are people themselves who have said, I have a great discomfort being in this physical gender dysphoria.
Okay.
But it's like saying, for example, that somebody who has schizophrenia, or this is closer to home, bipolar disorder. My father has bipolar disorder, okay? Undiagnosed for many years. He's an artist. No one knew he had what used to be called manic depression. Nobody knew that because he's an artist. He's a crazy, literally crazy artist. He's expected to do the crazy things.